Hi, my name is Jonathan Jones, and I am a physical education teacher in elementary school in Bowie, Maryland, and I am also a member of the phys edagogy team. Welcome to the Phys Ed Summit 3.0. Thank you so much for joining us for the 24-hour back-to-back global event. We cannot make this day happen without you. Reminder that we are using technology, and things happen. If for some reason the video feed stops, please check out the toggle for the new link. It may take us a few minutes to get it started and rolling again. We thank you for your patience. First and foremost, we would like to thank you, the participants, for taking time to attend the summit. We are very humbled by the outpouring of support and promotion of the summit from each and every one of you. By sharing with one person, you're able to impact hundreds of students. Thank you so much for being here to push for best practices, effective physical education, and PD. This is an amazing PE community, and we are so excited to be a part of it. After the summit, we will post the feedback survey to the Phys Ed Summit 3.0 homepage. We hope that you will provide us with some feedback so that we can make 4.0 even better. In order to receive PD certificate, you will need to fill out the quick survey after the summit. Now it is my pleasure to introduce our presenter, Andy Hare. Andy is a teacher at Leopold Primary School in Victoria, Australia. He has been presenting at the state and national level for 5 years in a wide variety of physical education methods. In 2015, he has been prominent on the world scene, presenting at Phys Ed Summit 2.0, Shape Seattle, and a web series with Andy Vassily centered around unpacking invasion games. He's also led his own professional development program called iPhysical. And this year, he will be celebrating with iPhysical 2.0. He's also instrumental in linking more Australian physical education teachers so common languages can be used countrywide. It is my pleasure to introduce the awesome, enthusiastic, and amazing Andy Hare.
G'day Team Phys Ed. It gives me great pleasure to represent Australia at the Phys Ed Summit 3.0. My name is Andy Hare. I work at Leopold Primary School, based in Geelong, Victoria, Australia. I'd like you to sit back and enjoy as I take you on a journey I call Unpacking Phys Ed.
In this presentation, you'll hear how I use the idea of unpacking to provoke deeper individual learning. Several months ago, a great friend of mine, Andy Vassily, and I got together to start developing our units in conjunction across the idea of invasion games. Even though we were countries apart, we were trying to use the same common language as well as the same learning goals to really get children thinking the same way and start to work collaboratively together. One of the first things that Andy taught me was the power of provocation and setting the kids up for success right from the start. And he went on to discuss all about how making learning visible to the kids really, really allowed them to get a deeper understanding of what was about to happen. Because I'm in Australia and we were using invasion games, I thought it was only fitting to be able to use Australian rules football to show you a provocation that I would show my kids.
Nen explains the rules of Australian rules football. Australian rules football, more commonly known as Aussie rules football, is a game played with two teams of 22, with 18 players from each team taking to the field at any one time. The game is played on an oval field that's generally a maximum of 185 metres by 155 metres. This is by far one of the largest fields of any team sports, and players have to be extremely fit in order to cover this much ground. These are the goal squares, the centre square and centre circle, and there are two 50-metre lines arched around the goalposts at each end of the field. Pay attention now, as these lines are important. The game starts with a ball up in the centre square. The object of the game is for your team to score more overall points than the opposing team. To score, a player must try and kick the ball through the middle two posts. If you successfully kick the ball through the middle two posts, this is a goal and is worth 6 points. If you hit one of the goalposts, if the ball is deflected by another player through the goalposts, or if you kick it between a long goalpost and a short behind post, this is known as a behind and this only scores 1 point. The game is played in 4 20-minute quarters for a combined playing time of 80 minutes, so the team with the highest amount of points from goals and behinds at the end of time wins. Kicking a ball through a couple of goalposts for 80 minutes? That sounds dead easy. Well, not so much. Standing in your way are 18 members of the opposing team who are trying to take the ball away from you so that they can score themselves. They are allowed to block kicks, intercept the ball, push you off the field, or tackle you by grabbing you below the shoulders and pulling you to the floor. If they do tackle you, they are awarded a free kick from the spot of the tackle. To move the ball up the field, you have to be quick and you have to dispose of the ball before an opponent tackles you. You can move the ball by kicking it in any direction, running with it so long as you bounce it on the floor every 15 metres, or handballing the ball where you strike the ball with a clenched fist to a teammate. Throwing the ball is absolutely not allowed in Australian rules football, and your opponent will be awarded a free kick if you do. That doesn't sound so easy anymore. Is there any other way of moving the ball up the field? Yes, there is. The saving grace for your team is called the mark. If you kick the ball in the air 15 metres or more, and a teammate catches it without the ball bouncing on the ground, this is known as a mark or marking the ball. The player is then awarded a free kick from that spot and cannot be touched by an opponent for 10 seconds. If a mark is made within your team's forward 50 arc, you are awarded 30 seconds to take your free kick. If 10 or 30 seconds has expired without you making the kick, the umpire will call play on and the opponents are free to try and take the ball off you. The game is a back and forth affair full of marks, handballs, runs, goals, behinds and free kicks. But there's a few other things that you'll need to understand before playing or going to a game. For example, specky. This is Australian slang for spectacular mark. You're not allowed to push anyone in the back, but if there's a marking contest and an opponent is standing in your way, you are allowed to use his back for leverage to try and catch the ball for a mark. This could result in gravity-defying plays for the ball. Interchange. A team is allowed to interchange up to 3 players per game. Very similar to football, the players must wait in the interchange area and players must enter or exit at the designated areas. The maximum number of interchanges is 120. There is also one substitute in case of injury. 50-metre penalty. If you're stupid enough to commit any of these infractions, the umpire will award a 50-metre penalty against you and the other team will gain possession from the spot where the umpire has marked 50 metres. This is a huge disadvantage as games can be lost from kicks resulting in penalties. Kicks after the siren. If a player marks the ball and the siren goes off to signify the end of time, the game doesn't end there. You are allowed to take the kick. Any points scored from this kick counts. Games have been won, or in St Kilda's case, lost, from a kick after the final siren. To the uninitiated, Aussie rules football seems very complicated, but once you understand the rules, it becomes a great sport to watch. If you have found this video at all helpful, please like, share with your friends, rate, comment and subscribe. It takes me ages to make one of these things, and good karma is always appreciated. Aussie rules football is fast, high scoring, and hard hitting. What's there not to love?
So that was just a really, really cool video that I found on YouTube from nin.co.uk. And it really helped us emphasise there the importance of that game. Now, however, if you go out and you teach Aussie rules football as such right from the get-go and you expect kids to understand all of that, we're really kidding ourselves. And so that's where the power of unpacking comes into play. You can see there, just giving him a little bit of a plug, he's got a lot of recordings for a lot of rules of world sports, and that will fit in all of our TGFU units. I wanted to give you a real-life example now of how I was able to make learning visible. I'm going away from our invasion units that Andy and I put together, and I'm heading right back to my term one, where I was teaching high jump because we did a six-week athletics unit leading up to our house athletic sports. And I used Dick Fosbury as my provocation to the kids, and I showed him this video.
The 1968 Olympic Games proved to be a turning point in the history of the high jump event. Into the Mexico City Olympic Arena came not only a new name to the sport, but a new approach which was to revolutionize the high jump event. Dick Fosbury from the United States demonstrated a new style of high jump which some considered strange and awkward. It was a jump he had devised in the previous years and one which unsettled his opponents. While the crowd at first saw him as a novelty, his continued success at clearing the ever-increasing height soon made it apparent he was a serious contender. Valentin Gavrilov from the Soviet Union failed at his attempt of 2.22 meters, while Fosbury and his US teammate Edward Carruthers cleared their way to a jump-off. The bar sat at 2.24. Carruthers failed, and Fosbury took his new style of high jump over the bar and into the history books. Fosbury had won his gold. Within a few years, the Fosbury flop had become the standard method of jumping in this great Olympic sport.
There as a really good lesson starter for the kids, and it was only a minute and a half video, and just to get the kids an idea of the style we were looking at and where it came from history wise. I then set up my TVs with my high jump mats, and you can see there in the TV screens we've got the high jump mat which is sitting in front. On that right hand TV I've got video delay app on my iPad, and the iPad's little blue just to the right of that hole. It's just poking around the corner. And so the camera was constantly filming the kids in about an 8 second delay. On the left-hand side on my laptop, I had set up a repeated GIF, and it just looped over and over and over. And what I did there is I used a very good example of a age-appropriate student at my school of the high jump. And the high jump was able to... she was able to then demonstrate to the students the desired method at an age-appropriate level and at the learning journey that most of them have already been on as well. As the kids came over, you'll hear now in the video what sort of transpired.
I want you to go on that side this time. Jack. Great work, Jack. Come over to the TVs, have a look. Okay, so we've landed up onto our back, compared that to that side. And both you and Amika are landing in this right spot. Well done, Jack.
Thanks.
Yeah. Tyler, come here, mate. Let's have a look. So Tyler, when you twisted, you've twisted around the wrong way. I think you're better starting on that side for me, okay? Because I've got to get you right, coming on the right side of your body. Good, well done. Let's try and get you on your back a lot more. Good, come have a look.
What completed that was meeting the man himself. And when I went to Seattle in March this year, I was very fortunate to catch up with quite a few of the listeners today in Seattle. And this really completed this learning journey for not only myself, but for the students back in my class. Because in walked Dick Fosbury at the Sheraton Hotel. And I was able to spend 5 minutes with him of valuable time and explain to him that only 2 weeks prior I had spoken to the students in my class, used his 1960s video as provocation of learning with the students to really provoke the desired action and learning within the students. And he was so humbled and so touched and really honored to know that across the other side of the world, there was teachers using his style and his videos that were on YouTube to engage students into physical activity. So that was such a wonderful experience to really complete that learning journey for me. After I do a bit of provocation, I realize that 5 minutes, kids have come into physical education, they've sat for 5 minutes, they've listened to Mr. Hare, they've watched a quick little video, so they get an idea what they're doing, they want to move. So we go into a quick small-sided game. I break up the students into about three or four teams, and then break those groups into half again to play some small-sided games. So this is just a quick illustration of 3-on-3. I try and make it related to the activity, but the sole purpose of my small-sided game, it's a warm-up game. It's there to get the blood moving in the body. I do a lot of tag games, a lot of layering games where there's three or four stages. I love the idea of trying to keep the kids into the mode of computer games. So we talk about level one, where when we say go, the kids just get up and move freely about the space. Then we enter a rule, add a rule to the game. We let that go for a couple of minutes, then we add one more rule. We let that go for a couple of minutes, then we add another rule to really start to build into that leveling up experience. And I'll use that phrase a few times. As the kids walk into this gym and around the gym, I have a lot of priming for success questions. And I'm really, really big on the kids using this information in sedentary areas. So these windows are the entrance into the gym where the kids wait for the last class to finish before they go in. So as they walk in, I call it the holding pen. They're in the holding pen and they're churning at the bit. They're ready to roar into class. They're ready to work as hard as they possibly can. So I throw these questions up. The one on the left, how are you going to be successful during PE? So they're starting, I want them to think about it. What is your goal? So we spoke about goals last week, so I'm wanting them to remember those goals. And can you show a buddy a new skill? I'm so big on as many teachers as we possibly can get in physical education. I may be the only employed teacher in there, but I've got 25 kids that all have something that they can show someone else that will improve the quality of someone else's ability. So I'm huge on showing a buddy a new skill. After our small-sided warm-up game, I then ask the students, what do we know about invasion games? Currently, I'm working on strike and fielding. So this week coming, it's all about base running and running between wickets or running between bases. So what do we know about running between wickets if we're playing cricket? For those of you that happen to drop into my session in Seattle with cricket, you'll know all about what I'm talking about, and you know the words that relate to it as well, and the talking between players, and the whole different physical literacy that goes with running between wickets. Running between bases. It doesn't matter what sport you're in, the fundamentals will remain the same in it. So what we do is we use community circles. So I ask that question, but I'm standing in the middle of a group. And I use these community circles a few different ways. I'm going to show you a quick little snippet of this one. The kids are bouncing the ball around. I've actually asked them in this video example to tell me words that describe good sportsmanship, because the week prior they were displaying poor sportsmanship. So you can see there inside that video, sometimes things still go wrong, but the pretense of it is that every student is to stand on the red line of the basketball free throw area. They all have a number on there. So the kids are come, they come in as their number. That's their plickers number. So it all relates and it all gels together. So they come in, they stand on that number when I whistle them in. And then the best thing about a community circle is every single person is accountable. Every single person is visible. There's no one hiding up the back. There's no one with their back turned. There's no one sitting in someone else's lap. And I can see you guys all out there nodding away, thinking, I know exactly what Andy's talking about there because that is kids in my class. So when they face each other, that accountability really comes into play. And quite often when I'm setting up a learning focus, I'll sit in the middle of the class. I'll stand in the middle of the circle and I'll walk around. After our work there in the circle, we then move into a larger activity. But I want to keep going at this stage with what do students know. And I want to show a little bit of an example that of when Andy Vasily and myself were doing the Two Andy show. We recorded a documentary on using Padlets, and it was all about the kids using Padlet to throw up the information that they knew about invasion games. So have a listen to this.
The idea of what are the skills necessary to succeed in invasion games. My students, one of the big ideas was scoring.
Yes. So
you've actually went in a direction to say, name the invasion game itself and name, you know, use the terminology for scoring. So that's what you've done. So same idea, but your kids have just actually chosen to the actual sports and how to describe the scoring feature itself.
That's it. And yeah, we were having a chat with Sarah today on via Twitter, and we were saying that exact same thing, that we set our kids up to answer in the way we actually describe the question. And indirectly, I've probably described this question with an example, which has then led the kids to actually start to answer this way. So then I had a cohort of kids that actually didn't think of major sports, and these kids may be kids that actually don't play major sports outside school. So they've gone into games like minor games that we've played as warm-up activities in class, like your tiki games, your octopus, your someone's written dodgeball there, so it's been a few years since I played dodgeball, but spiders and flies and stuff like that. I'm so surprised no one has put my favourite, the Joey Fife Star Wars, or this week was Batman and Robin, so I'm a bit disappointed those didn't show up. Down the very bottom, we then had skill-specific, so kids that actually, instead of shooting, because shooting is an outcome of a skill, but down the bottom we had kids like showing me that in football they needed to kick the ball to be successful in an invasion game. Stop when you have the ball in netball, hockey, defend the goals. And I thought that one was a brilliant one, defend the goals and hit goals. And there was another really, really cool one from the hockey that I thought, it was over to the left-hand side there. Hockey, knock the ball away from your opponent so they don't get the ball and get a goal. So it's Easter, which I meant to write easier, to pass it to your teammate. And I thought that was sensational. And then on this side of here was just the kids that just named a sport. So that was really cool. And then what we were really cool and really – the kids were rapt because all of a sudden Mr. Vasily popped up with his face giving the kids some feedback there. But then you were able to go on that same site just from a link and put in your work that you've been doing with your kids. So my kids were able then to learn from your kids in real time and build on the ideas from your teaching all across the waters to my school at that same time. And I reckon that was just amazing. So if we have a look at yours, that poster that you held there, we can actually bring that up just here on the screen. So we're looking at all your lovely artwork and the leading question here and the different things that we needed to start unpacking. So you can see there that we had scoring, we had that heavy group of kids with the scoring. We have the movement patterns down the bottom, running, chasing, dodging. So the kids were able to...
That's what kind of is interesting with running, chasing, dodging. Again, like when I record my student answers in the journal, I don't judge them as being right or wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
What I will do is take the most common answers and then post them. So the running, chasing, dodging were the most common.
So yes.
I knew that was agility, but I was going to have discussions with the kids to bring that out. So the next class that came actually said, well, good running is chasing and dodging. So then we classified it under the same. So that's why I did a circle around running, chasing, dodging. Yes. There was separate before. And then we put under the unpacking of good running, we included chasing and dodging. And then we renamed the category. It was a perfect chance for me to introduce the concept of agility. So we renamed the category agility.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. And then we moved on and we were able to then look at your invasion games today. This was, I think, your introduction one with grade fours. So that popped up as well. And it was really cool just to see the difference in answers from one year level to the next. And again, talking with Sarah via Twitter today, and she presenting the case that the grade sixes that she had were of the similar mindset in their answers of that question as to our grade three fours. So what grade did you have in this one?
That's still grade four. So everything that you see, all those visuals are only grade four. I'm only doing invasion games in grade four right now.
Yeah.
So all those visuals are yeah, definitely. So right there, good defending is spreading out in space, focusing on attackers in your space, communicating with your teammates, stopping people closest to scoring, and good teamwork. Good attacking, pretend to do one thing but do another. That was a great one. Knowing when to go, spreading out, finding space, creating holes. Now, some of those answers came from students that already play a lot of sport and understand that. And I had these. I started 2 years ago. I did invasion games in grade two. So some of these students, probably 50 to 60% of the students, have stayed in the school. So they're now in grade four. So they already know some of these ideas, right? So I just felt it was important to speed up the process with the unpacking to kind of honor what they already know.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, Andy, the thing I love the most about it is that all of a sudden with this explicit teaching, you're empowering the kids to reach a whole new level. And I had one kid that has he's mucked around a fair bit this year and maybe showed a little sign of being bored. What I saw was with the invasion skills, that all of a sudden this kid wouldn't take his eyes off my feet. And I was playing in the role of the attacker and he was playing in the role of the defender. And he was able to watch my feet the whole time. And even when I egged him on and I told him, mate, you got to look at me in the eyes, you got to look at me in the eyes, because I was trying to get past him, he wouldn't take his eyes off my feet. And that preconceived idea, do you know what he told me he learned it from? He learned it from FIFA on the computer. He said, because all my defenders, their eyes are on the feet when he plays it in real person time. And I thought that was really, really cool. So,
right? He's learning, he's applying it in a new situation.
Oh, absolutely. So, you know, in that, if he was in your class, good defending is keeping my eyes on the feet positioning of the attacker.
And that's what they say, right? Oftentimes, when you go for the head fake, you're left hanging onto your jock strap.
This conversation that Andy and I had, it went for a good 30 minutes. And you can actually track down that the YouTube clip. And there was a three-part series in this. And you can track it down there on the bottom of the slide there. I've got my my web address and where you can find that. But it was so powerful. And we worked with the students as well, and I wanted to show a couple of videos that Andy's students had put together. One was his kid coach that we called him, but obviously he's not my student, so I didn't want to include him in my presentation today. But I'm sure if you ask Andy about that, he might be able to share that video with you. This was a website called Padlet. And a teacher at Nanjing International School had actually shown Andy this website, and Andy and I jumped all over it and started using it and grouping all the ideas. I'm going to show you now actually how the kids used it.
So you can see all my work so far. I know that we're into the presentation. We're almost halfway through. But you can see the amount, the volume of work that we do right at the start of the unit. The kids, it may appear that the kids are sitting for all this time, but this is such crucial work, setting the kids up for success. And if they can have that success there at their fingertips, then they are able to work with that when we start to build their knowledge. So this is Padlet at work.
So this is it, man. We've got these kids are working in small groups. And then up on the TV, you can start to see, I'll flick that back in a sec.
This is two classes.
You can start to see their answers. And what I love that it's running out of space with all their ideas, because now we're going to be able to go and group all those.
So they're using their iPads there, and then they're going up and able to see them lifetime. And they're able to see Andy's class putting up his answers as well. Now, Andy's class was 2 hours behind ours. So these guys were working at the same time, same classes, and starting to build ideas between two classes internationally. And it was just simply amazing. And then we had Evan Goldsmith and Sarah Gitchy Hartman. They jumped on, and Commando Kids from Werribee, he jumped on and started commenting. So the kids were working alongside each other, along their peers. But then they started seeing the teachers were in there as well, so they were able to ask the teachers questions. Now, you may sit there and go, well, this is very good, Andy, and I can see how it's great for setting the scene and building ideas at the start of the lesson. But as the kids work, they get ideas throughout the lesson. So how does that work? Well, it works like this. So I have my iPads out, and I have an iPad bank. So I just throw them out, four there, and I allow the kids to withdraw themselves at any time once they have a light bulb go off, a big, bright idea. And when they have that big idea, they can go over to the iPad, find space, tap it in, and away they go. And no one else is able to delete that answer, because it belongs to that one person who's actually logged into, or who has typed in that answer. So it's really cool, and it's really creative. You do get the kids going, hi, I'm Ethan, or hi, Billy, or just writing their name straight out. But, you know, you jump on that straight away, and the kids with a little bit of with a little bit of rope, you can pull them back in as they get going. Obviously, this is something that I use probably for 3, 4, 5, 6. But my younger ones, I go to the book. And again, Andy showed me this one. He has these big posters, and I was always just trying to work out how am I going to keep these all together. And I looked and I looked and I looked and I looked and I looked, and I could not find the right platform to be able to use. I didn't want pieces of paper hanging all over the place. My gym is a joint use gym, so after hours the community come in, so I can't keep posters up on the walls. And when I've tried that, I come in the next day and they're ripped and they're on the floor. And so I ended up finding an A1 size scrapbook, and the kids write all their answers in the scrapbook. So these are grade ones. So their provocation question would have been, or sorry, their leading question would have been, what do we know about throwing or catching? I can't remember. And again, they're allowed to come over at any stage once the light bulb goes off and write their answer then. At the end, we just group their answers together and we work out what they actually know. And then that helps me find what they actually need to move on to. What do I know about the forehand strike? So then you can just see there, we've got 3 or 4 kids hanging around. The great thing, again, teachers, I know you're brilliant at this. Those listening to the Phys Ed Summit, if you only want 4 people at the table, only put 4 texters out. I made that mistake straight away where I put a tub of texters out and found I had no one actually doing the activities and everyone waiting around the table to write in the book. And I just go two pages, so double side, and allow the kids to write across those two pages, because then it creates a lovely big piece of artwork that we can go through and become accountable for as well. Sometimes I'm on the go, so I actually don't have the time to have the book out or even have Padlets out if I'm in the middle of the oval, but I do have a whiteboard. So again, this was with my grade five. So what invasion skills are common in basketball and netball? So the grade five started to flick around and go on top of that. And because I have my same year level back to back, I then am able to build upon ideas. And the second class coming in, harder or easier, I'm not the one to judge, but the answers are already up there and I'm looking for new answers. So it's probably harder for them because the easy answers have already been thrown up. And then we go around and as the game's been played, and I'll show you in a minute, we start to tick off things that we're actually doing well. And that helps me set up next week's lesson based on what the actual kids have left that they're not doing really well. And that's it. I love the word organic to describe that, because next week's lesson is based on this week's output. Not because the page number four tells me I have to do this lesson. I'm really, really huge on that, not using textbook lesson planning. So the output comes like this. So once the kids have all done their brainstorming in week one and a little bit of week two, we then come into three leading questions, which equal my three learning intentions and gives me a chance to then set up some sort of assessment around this. So this was my grade fives in invasion games. Three strategies we are looking at in invasion games. Attacking, how are you moving the object towards the goal? Defending, how are you trying to stop the object getting closer to the other team's goals? Finding space, how are you finding, I should have had the word creating, space when attacking and closing space when defending? So they are the things that were left out on the board that the kids actually didn't say that they were doing well. So then they became our three learning intentions and they became my accountable measures. And for the kids, they then became accountable to that because we're able to use those questions at any time and use those questions to really set up the lesson as such. Now, when we're teaching TGFU, because I've been talking about striking and fielding invasion games, and I know that I'm talking about the journey of my last terms, unpacking the unit. We need to address skill development, because without proper skill development, the students cannot reach the success level that they really desire or really have in their head, because they don't have the fundamentals of the basic activities, the movement patterns, the throw, the catch, the overhand throw, the kick, the punt, the two-hand strike, the forehand strike, balance movements, running, dodging, chasing, all those agility senses. If they haven't had that entrenched into them in the 3 to 4 years, so prep 1, 2, 3, just solid every single week, use them in games, use them as tabloid stations, send them home as homework activities, absolutely flood the student's brain with the fundamental motor skills, then if they haven't had that, they're not going to be able to reach the same levels of success as someone that has had 4 years of just flooded fundamental motor skills development. And it really sets the students up. So every time I present, I really put a lot of effort into making sure that people know that the first years of primary school are so golden in skill development, and it's okay to just have skill practice and repetitive over and over and over. It is okay to repeat last week's lesson, because if a student can do that same activity 10 times, they're going to start to actually get it as a purposeful movement. If they do it once, it's going to be something they're not going to be able to retain. And this is where and you're gonna love hearing this, but this is where, and it's actually gonna hurt you too, but this is where our classroom teachers really need to take the lead, and they need to go, okay, well, every day I've got to give the kids a chance to get up out of their seats, out of the classroom and practice. Throw the classroom teacher 20 tennis balls, get the kids throwing, catching, kicking, bouncing it around the school. It doesn't cost a lot, tennis balls. Down to your local tennis club, we'll give them to you for almost nothing. And trying to get the teachers to get the kids out, because the more that they can practice, the more that they will retain the skills. So skill development is so crucial, PE teachers. Another huge thing that I'm really, really big on when I'm unpacking it is to play with purpose. Is there a learning outcome attached to the content of your lesson? Do the students know what this is? I want to ask this question, and you can nod or shake your head. Doesn't matter, because I can't see you anyway. But do you have a learning outcome attached to everything that you do? Do you walk into class on a Monday morning and go, yeah, all right, we'll get the bag of balls out today, and all right, we'll play that elimination game that the kids love playing? And as a teacher, do you join in? As a teacher, do you walk away from that lesson and go, hey, that was so cool? And as a teacher, do you remember what happened yesterday? Or are you just thinking about what's happening tomorrow? We need to be accountable, guys. We need to know that we are actually moving kids from A to B. We're moving kids from A to C. We're moving kids from A to Z. We're moving them through a journey that their kids can start to succeed. I was talking to Colin Brooks just the last couple of days, and we're talking about a great idea about leveling up. And I know Colin had tweeted several months ago about digital badges that he had made, and a great idea I had was producing these digital badges, but in stages. So in my fundamental motor skills, I know that a student can master a two-hand strike in 3 years, but that may be broken down into five stages before they can be called to master that. So I would have five digital badges, all in different colors, and have the kids earn a stage and get them a big celebration when they know that they've actually conquered that stage. And really understand the differentiated learning and where the kids are at. And if you can ask a child, okay, what stage are you at with fundamental motor skills? With the two-hand strike, and they say, well, I'm at silver. Then as a teacher, you know, okay, they got two to go. They're almost at gold level here. This student is excelling. Let's push them hard to master it. And when they master it and they finish that last one, they get that last digital badge, you have a huge celebration, because it is a big thing. My school's all into digital portfolios and the kids keeping all their work and uploading all their work. So using digital badges will have a really big effect on what my kids do. It starts to gamify it. It really puts the learning into kids' language. They love computer games, so why not make our classes very similar, where the kids can level up, be rewarded for their effort, and at any time you can ask them, what level are you on? And they'll tell you the color that they're on, or they'll tell you what, if your badge has a name, they'll be able to tell you what name they're at, and you'll be able to know, because you've got strong learning outcomes attached to each of those levels. You'll know how to push them from one level to the next. It's a great idea. The other big thing too is, I'm huge on being explicit, not a secret agent. What I do, it's not for me to retain. If I retain it, then I'm not serving the purpose of being a great teacher. I need to think of an idea. I need to implement it. I need to tell as many people as I possibly can that idea was the bomb. It was absolutely sensational. I love walking into my principal's office, knocking on the door, coming in and giving her a new idea and showing her that what I'm doing in physical education is purposeful, is meaningful, and is straight at what the kids need. Timeouts. I use a lot of timeouts to explain new concepts to kids. I'm going to show you an example now of a timeout that I called based on the whiteboard that we had a few slides.
Now we've just played our small court keepings off. Now we want to check back in on these skills. All right. So having a look at these skills, we're going to go through a few of them. I'm going to start ticking off the ones that you are doing. And then we want to build on that. We want to make sure you continue to do those ones, but we want also bring in any ones that you think are new. Okay, but also we want to look at those ones that you're not doing and find a way to be able to include them in. So what was your new one?
Try and take control of the player that's got the ball.
Control of the player, good. So what do you mean by that? Can you explain that?
Like if someone's got the ball, you try and everyone get around them so they've got no choice like anywhere to throw. They've got it. If they throw it, you're gonna get it anyway.
That's really cool. Good job.
Attack groups, like you could attack someone if they had the ball in like groups, a group.
Yep. Yeah. So aim for those groups. Good.
Sunrise.
Charlie, we'll just try and keep the camera still, mate.
Yep.
Attack groups. I should have put that up with attack there.
Okay. I got one.
All right, so now we want to go through and we want to have a look now what we're doing. So we know we've taken control of plat. Okay. Teamwork. Has there been teamwork out?
Another timeout I use a PMO chart. So in this one, positive, minus, and outcome.
So on our plus, minus, outcome, so we've talked about our pluses, things that are working really well in our group, okay? Let's now talk about any minuses, so things that are annoying us in our game that we can tweak. In the last class, we had a few people skipping other people down the line. Then we had the same back person. Well, you've already told me that if we rotate the back person, that's a big plus. Not saying stop. So that person that's got the chicken, before they throw it, they're not saying stop. Is there anything else that's annoying anyone? Andy?
We're all screaming and we can just go, oh, come on guys, get in the huddle, like one person.
Yep. So.
So again, giving the kids a voice. So the kids have got back into that community circle. We've discussed what we're doing, and all of a sudden we've come up with these plus, minus, and outcomes. So the outcome's directly related to the minus, and it's trying to change behaviour so then that can work in and become a plus as well. So we want more in the plus. That's what we're looking for. Looking forward there in our learning. So all these are great strategies to unpack it. It's that deeper thinking that we're trying to provoke with kids. Using larger games, but using simpler rules. So this was a game that we just called bucket ball, and the emphasis purely was on the fielders. Sorry, this one was the emphasis was on the striking at the start. So I didn't care what the fielders were doing. I didn't care what the base runners were doing. What we were trying to get was trying to get the batter to hit through the field. They're all our students with their buckets, so the buckets just gave them larger hands to catch. And then when we leveled up, we went into talking about fielding. So this is a quick little video of giving the fielders an idea of how to set themselves up.
All right, so this time what we're going to do, okay, we've got to reduce the amount of people that are on the infield. So we're going to start with two people on the infield, and they're going to be like a pitcher. Then we're going to have two people at first base, two people at second base, two people at third base, and the rest can go out into the outfield. So remember, cover those gaps, spread out, get your hands ready in that ready position. All right, off you go.
Into position. Not all kids will get into the right position, but that's where differentiation comes in. That's where my role as an activator will start to move forward to work with individual kids. Those that get it will get it well. Those that don't, they need my help. That's why I'm there. Huge time to reflect. When we reflect, we break, we do a few different things. This next little video, my student is strategizing.
Nice organisation, coach. Sticks in.
One, two, three. Pepperoni. Three. Pizza.
So they had 30-second timeout. Let's go. To talk about different ideas that they're doing and refocus in. There was no group leader there, but the dominant voice started to talk over, and that's okay. Some students just need guidance. Another great example, I had these are my grade sixes talking straight.
Someone else, you, and I throw it down here.
Hey, I'm
good.
No,
I'm good.
Wait, so you put the back, then you run.
No. So you here, and then there's the touchdown here.
Can I
record that? Just wait. Wait,
so who's
running? Whoever
does,
who's
going to
run it?
Yeah.
So they were setting up a play. They were playing flag football. I do a bit of timeout talk as well, just trying to regroup kids. In our larger games, keep drawing students back to the three learning intentions. It's imperative you do every time. Stop, reflect, draw back, start again. The cycle is a continuous cycle. It's an enriching cycle. It really helps shape a lesson. This is a great activity. We had to refocus a few times. We were doing target games. Kids had to set up their own mini golf course. They then had to go play other kids' golf courses. And we had to revisit the learning intentions a few times to get the kids to actually set up a hole which was realistic for them to play. It was a wonderful session, this one. Embedded concepts. So again, specific to the TGFU unit that you're using. But things like leading, stoppages, attack, disputes, strategy, scoring, closing space, outwitting, defending, playing positions, opening space. Do your kids know what that means? If they don't, then that's your learning task. Work out. Give the kids the power of literacy in physical education, and you will give them the power to perform. It is massive. Try not to use language kids don't understand, the kids don't know, because they won't get what you're talking about. It's absolutely imperative that we explain, we put up on the whiteboard, we give the kids all the power to do and to be hugely successful. Assess and reflect. So again, measure against the three leading questions. Students, make them accountable for their learning. Teachers, be accountable for students' learning. My methods of reflection are journals, websites, Voxer, Twitter, long ride or run, whatever takes your fancy. But reflect. It makes us more powerful as teachers. Breaking down their own learning. I really encourage students to break their own learning down and to really see reason in what they do and be purposeful in what they do as well. This young chap was talking about the seagull and the chip. It's a very Aussie thing, but basically in football, he was making the analogy between all the players wanting to jump on the football at the same time and be the one to take the kick and kick a goal and stuff like that. In Australia, we have seagulls and we have hot chips. And the seagulls love to eat the chips. And when you throw a chip out of the window down the beach, you'll get 1,000 seagulls jumping in and trying to jump onto that one chip. I've got a unit flowchart that I tried to build, and it's very organic because I went to put it in a circle with the first one was provocations, but a circle doesn't work, and I'll tell you why in a second. What do students know? What are the three leading questions? Play a small-sided game. Have some timeouts. Build upon learning. Revisit concepts. Change the challenge. Assess and reflect. The reason why you can't put that in a circle is because they happen at different times. And you may have one lesson that it all flows in order. You may have a second lesson and it may go in a different order. It's totally up to the students. The students lead the lesson. We guide them through it and we focus them. The big game changer in unpacking phys ed is using innovation. I challenge you to challenge the boundaries. Don't do what you did yesterday. Find a new way to do it. A great example, the power of Voxer. And I know you guys know how powerful Voxer is. And it's so powerful between teachers, but it's even more powerful between students. Grovedale Primary School, a local primary school, and my primary school joined forces, and we allowed the students to actually address each other through Voxer and to answer each other's questions via a little bit of supervision at the same time. But all of a sudden, the collaboration and the digital citizenship that was going on was absolutely amazing. And the learning outcomes for the kids going home that night and saying, I had an impact in a physical education class at a different school was huge, absolutely huge. Using Voxer as a virtual teacher. So, you know, I've got a heap of iPods, iPod Touches. And so I've been able to put Voxer onto those iPod Touches and a set of headphones and have a group work independently. But at any moment, I can send them a Vox and change the task. And they're working independent from the other class or from the rest of the class. But at the same time, using a virtual teacher there at any time to change the focus of what they do and really to challenge them just in a different setting. The walkie-talkies, you know, using walkie-talkies in your class is such a cool idea. We had them when we were kids. We climbed trees with them. We all had a college roommate that you had a walkie-talkie with. So use them. I use them in my programs called Little Leaders and CPEP units. I get the kids to act like a pro coach. My Little Leaders program, so this is a really cool one. I sort of discovered and annoyed me a little bit that I'd get the kids into a circle in class and the same three or four kids would answer the questions that I was asking. So what I identified was I identified in my class four or five kids that were able to act as a leader, and those students were able to then take four or five other kids underneath their wings and follow the message that I was trying to put forward. And they worked with me, and then they had their own students that were accountable to them. And this has really empowered those students and given those students 2 minutes of power, where every single person in the class gets a chance to have a voice. Right or wrong, doesn't matter. They have a voice to move forward. So you can see there, the questions are written on the whiteboard. They come over to me, the five little leaders, and we'll write the questions on the whiteboard so it's common. I'll whistle up the rest of the group. We have that 2 minute break time, the timeout break, refocus, get those kids answering questions, accountable to those leaders. I'm experimenting coming up in a couple of weeks, actually putting walkie-talkie on each of those little leaders, and then in a group game when they're on the field, actually being able to talk to them like an NFL coach and have that earpiece so they can change the play in live action without having to stop and start. I'll let you know how we go with that. A great big question is, does quality physical education exist at Leopold? My tick is yes. Ladies and gentlemen, I love teaching physical education. I love connecting, and I love Twitter and Voxer. Twitter and Voxer has given me a voice. It's given me other teachers in my office. It's given me people to bounce ideas off. It's given me direction to be able to work towards a goal, work towards my Everest. You know, there are some amazing physical education teachers out there, and you're one of them, and you are doing such an amazing job in your school, and I'm aspiring to be like every single one of you. So keep doing what you're doing. Keep up the quality of physical education. Unpack your units. Unpack your physical education. It doesn't have to exist as you, a whistle, and your students. Change the boundaries. Change what you do. Have a look at best practice models and really inspire the kids. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Andy Hare. My Twitter is at Mr. Hare Phys Ed. You can catch me there at Voxer. Mr. Hare PE, and all my work is documented on mrharephysed.weebly.com. It's been an absolute pleasure to present to the Phys Ed Summit 3.0 on Unpacking Phys Ed, and I hope in this short amount of time I've been able to give you a few tricks and tips to be able to take back into your physical education program. Contact me at any stage. I love to talk physical education. I've had the pleasure to travel this year, and the pleasure will be coming again in the next few years. So I really hope that if I haven't met you in the past, I'm going to meet you in the future. Thank you very much for listening, and I bid you farewell.